Hello, good afternoon. Thank you all for coming. So I'd like to introduce you Patricia Alessandrini. Patricia is a lecturer in sonic arts at the Department of Music at Goldsmiths, University of London. So we were briefly colleagues there in 2013-2016. And Patricia organizes also a residency here in Madeira. So she's been doing that regularly. It just ended a week ago in Ponta do Sol. So we also, I would like to thank Raul for organizing and Elsa for the community team. So we took this opportunity that Patricia was here for the residency to invite her to make a presentation of her work here to the Miki community. So thank you all for coming and for your interest. Without any further delay, pass the floor to Patricia. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nuno, and thank you for all of your work in Dublin for having me here. It's really a pleasure to come here and also for the tour and to see what you're doing. I'm going to talk a little bit, the thing that I would like the most to talk about is the most recent project, which is making the physical computing system which sort of intervenes with the action of the piano. To excite the strings in a different way, but I thought I should tell you a little bit the path which by which I came to this point. So that's one thing about physical modeling to physical computing. Actually, Nuno had a better version of this, because from physical modeling to modeling the physical, which is in a sense what I'm going to do. So what I started by doing is, on the time, I have been working with IRCAM. For some years. Do people know what IRCAM is? It's an institute in Paris for research on acoustics and music. It has a very certain kind of orientation, which is very much score-based music. So I have been doing a lot of this score-based music. And one of the things I had been doing was working with physical modeling and different kinds of ways of modeling sounds. So for instance, in this piece, I had worked with the idea of having a guitarist. Imagine if the guitarist had little bells on the wrist, little sleigh bells, and imagine if they were larger bells that were on the neck of the guitar. So these are all modeled physically. And actually, the first kind of modeling for these small sleigh bells, if you think about it, if you want to model small bells, it's not so much the shape and the size of the bells that you will be modeling, but the behavior, the stochastic behavior of when which bells are ringing. So I used a model which is called FISM, so it's a physically inspired stochastic model, and this was to model the behavior. So it's actually a kind of additive synthesis in which you can choose the peaks of the synthesis. And you can also choose the number of these bells which are sounding. So this is a little bit what it sounds like. And what I do here is, if you see here, these are the standard sleigh bell peaks. So if I did the synthesis and just wanted it to sound like sleigh bells, this is essentially the peaks that I would choose. But then what I was doing is, I was doing, you can't see it here. And then I was analyzing the guitar playing in real time at a digital microphone, which is inside the whole guitar. So while the guitarist is playing, I'm getting the peaks from that analysis, and I'm basically making an interpolation between, so that these sleigh bells are constantly, in a sense, tuning themselves to what the guitarist is doing. So this is just a little bit more of that. So what you can hear is, I must have been a couple of thousand of these sleigh bells, so it becomes a kind of noise because it's so many of them that are playing at the same time. And you can hear that the sound is constantly shifting. So if I play that for you, so just give you a little taste of what that sounds like in the piece.
Thank you.
that's my internal audio cloud of the Amazonian people. But what you hear is when you hear these bell-like sounds, basically when there's the when there's this amplitude peak, there are these larger bells which are physically modeled that are sounding. So the other larger bells are actual physical modeling. So what I did was describe the shape, thickness, and so on of the shape, and then make an interaction which was basically kind of hitting these bells. And again, the bells are tuned to the guitar, but what I have is different sets of bells. So according to the analysis of the guitar, those change. So that was just giving you a little bit of an idea of what I was doing before I started working with physical objects. Another way that I was bringing together the physical with some kind of electronic material was by doing a kind of matching, which is called concatenative synthesis. So what I would do is I would have a bank of sounds, which, for instance, you could derive this bank just from someone improvising. So I have someone improvise, do an automatic segmentation of that improvisation. So then I would have these kind of sound objects from it. And then take some kind of a source and find the closest match according to certain sound descriptors to that source. So this is just a demo. This is actually from an existing film. I made this demo because I was working on a multimedia project with someone else, and when I wanted to show them basically how this was working. So I took this film. You know, in a film, when the character is speaking to themselves, but they're not moving their lips, it's just their voice. So what I did was I took that voice over and I just replaced it completely with guitar. So what it's doing is it's matching, there's an automatic segmentation, and it's matching segment by segment the voice. And then sometimes you hear the voice together. Strange effect, as if the characters are actually producing those musical sounds. So it's not composed once again, it's just an algorithm which is matching this, and obviously I adjust the algorithm, the thresholds and all the descriptors to get a certain effect. So again, this move to the physical was kind of cemented, and this is in 2010. When I did a kinetic installation. So these were suspended instruments in place in which the sound was radiating from them. And these are instruments which are designed by a colleague of mine. Oops, oh, this is an expected thing. These are quite large. This is about the size of the limits. It's a little taller than me, this one. These instruments were suspended in a space. And the idea was that they would play this quartet. And this quartet is a slow movement with this very suspended harmony. And so what I did was I took many recordings of this and then slowed it many times down to get a sort of a rich texture. And then transmitted that through these little modified speakers. They're basically just speakers, because as you know, a speaker is actually moving with the frequency, And if you take one of these speakers and cut away a little bit at its cone, then it would even move more. And what this has on it, I don't know if I zoom in a little bit more, you can see, what it has is, it has a little, just a little bottle cap put onto the cone, so that when you send frequencies through, it actually hits material. And then, you, of course, you could put a different material, something rubber or something like this, on the cone. So it's using the speaker for this physical interaction. And so, obviously, there's a lot of, and also I use close miking. This is another one. This is a miniature microphone on the instruments to pick up the sound. And then the speakers that were hidden very high up in the installation, because I didn't want people to see speakers. I want people to think, okay, the sound is coming from these objects. And I know there's a lot of things on there, but then when you pass underneath it in the installation, it's not quite so apparent. I also use larger transducers on some of the other objects. So then what was happening is, you see this bent position of the plates. The plates were slowly bent by motors while they were playing. So what I was doing is tuning them to the different frequencies of the quartet during the installation. And they make one slow movement. I was partly influenced at that time by the work of Anish Kapoor. I don't know if people know the artist Anish Kapoor, who is using extremely slow movement in his artwork. And my idea was that the idea of this slow movement would correspond with the slow moving sound at the same time. So they make the installation runs in a loop of 23 minutes, and the speaker, the plates start in a kind of relaxed position, and they make a very, very slow bending up, and then down again. So I also used physical modeling in this project, because the idea was that the plates were bending. obviously the instruments that were made could not bend. Like, for instance, the cymbal, I could not bend the cymbal. So what I did was, since I was amplifying that sound anyway, I used physical modeling to create two 3D meshes. One of a version, this is actually the more realistic version of the cymbal, and this is a more bent version. And so I did interpolations between those, so as the plates would be moving, it was as if the cymbal would be moving. So its amplified sound was being filtered by these different physically modeled shapes. So this is what the installation looks like. I think I'm going to go to the video again. Let's see, so I can show you. So that first sound, that kind of bear-like sound in the beginning, that bear-like sound is that hitting of that little water bite speaker. That's actually being hit onto the cymbal. That is where it is, this is being hit. And now I'll show you a little bit this movement. So you see that here the plates, you see the plates are fairly in a relaxed position there. And then when we get to about the middle, it's here, you see that they're quite bent. And obviously, when the plates are more bent, they're more susceptible to higher frequencies. So in this part of the piece, I should say as well, there are different materials, the plates. There were two smaller ones, like that one you see, which are brass, and then there are two which are steel, and one of those two is stainless steel. So I spent a lot of time testing with them what frequencies at what angle, being bent, they were susceptible to. And what I was looking for, you hear a little bit there, you hear that kind of shaking in the sound. I was looking for these inharmonic reactions. Because of course it's easy enough to put the sound into it and then, you know, you sort of hear a radiation of that sound. But what's interesting is if you can get the modes to resonate in a way that's not necessarily, in a sense, not necessarily putting out what you're putting into it as a source. So this is this kind of higher material. That little raspy sound was those little spots that, again, sort of pushing rather to the limit and causing some artifacts. And you do hear this slow movement, which is the harmony of the long sound. Because this is all just recordings of string quartets. I know it doesn't sound like it, but I'm taking just particular frequency bands from these recordings and putting them into the things. So you hear, because it's derived from this harmony, you hear some of this harmony, but the idea was to really let these plates kind of speak their physical selves and to have material that suits the plates in a way. So in the idea of letting these plates kind of speak for themselves, at the end of this piece, it ends with a big, big cadence. And so the ending material was rather homogeneous. So what I did was I eventually just narrowed it down just to a single time sine tone and just let the movement of the plates be the only change in the sound. So from about here. So that's the sine tone. And what you're going to hear, yeah, this, that's the modulation of the sine tone by the plates. It's essentially an underwater environment. environment in which you have these avatars. You can see this avatar, and there's one avatar obviously for whoever joins the game. It's something that people in the audience were able to join using their smartphone or a or iPad, and, you know, any Android or Apple, iPhone. And yeah, this just says this is someone's iPhone over there. And basically, you're in this environment, and it's kind of the opposite ethic of a lot of video games. A lot of video games, you have to get the other and, you know, eat or kill a lot of other things. And this was the opposite, that you basically eat some plankton, which is this your plankton, and then you had to avoid either bumping the other players or bumping some of these other little natural amoeba in the water. So for me, this is experience again, just dealing with how to how to create an audio situation that was sending data to other places. And so this produced the score. So basically, the person who was playing the game would produce the score for the performers. And then there was a loop also that the performers, their audio was modifying this environment. It would control these little, basically the players, these were kind of their avatars, they would be mounted onto those. So that, just a little bit of a parenthesis again to say this trying to find this relationship between the visual experience and the experience of the players. So then, this is an experience that I used when I had this project called Mundgewächse, which was a residency for about a year with an organization called Share Music in Sweden. So Share Music, what they do is they organize artistic events for people with different abilities for inclusive practice in general. So it could be dance, visual art, and so on. So this was based around sound, but there was a strong visual art element as well. The video which you see here is done by one of my Goldsmith colleagues, Frida Abtan. So we worked together on the interaction design for that QVC, alongside some of the partners in that. Oh yeah, here we go. Here's the clip. So there were a few things that that we made for this, because the idea was not only to make a performance, which was played in the Gothenburg Art Sounds Festival, and to give an opportunity for people who had been taking these workshops to have this public performance, and in many ways shape the public performance themselves. We would have these workshops, and we would decide what are the thematics that you want to explore, what do you want to make, what do you want your role to be. So for instance, here we see Matilda, one of the participants, who's basically creating an artwork. And there's a video tracking of what she does, which then controls the score which performers are playing. And the performers were a mix of professional performers from a contemporary music ensemble and people who participated in these workshops. A lot of this was about the body and how our bodies are different and how we can kind of recreate ourselves. So people would come out for these kind of solos in front of these screens, but there was a lot of shadow play. And in the shadow play, people were using interfaces which were originally designed at Goldsmiths. You might have maybe heard about this, the Noise Bear project. So a project that used conductive stuffing, basically, for some kind of stuffed animal or some kind of object. So for this, we used a kind of a pillow, because we had some people who had different kinds of limited movement, and we found with this pillow, there were different ways that one could, you know, put it against the body and squeeze it. And then there was another part which had gestural data, which was kind of a freestanding sort of puppet part. So people were behind her playing with these puppets, which were giving data, which was changing the sound. So there was a kind of a double play, which is that they would be making these gestures to change the sound, and then she would be tracing their form, and that would produce. So it was kind of a loop So we used some very simple contrasts, like for instance, the whole red section was a whole different kind of musical material, so that there was a really clear overlap between that. Not just the spatiality of it, but the actual colours. Let me show you the next one. So this was another interface that was another two rings coming forward. So there's an existing instrument called Headspace, which is an instrument which is worn on the head and has a sip and blow straw. And basically what it does is it functions as a musical instrument so that the movements of the head become the different notes of the scale. And the straw becomes the onset of the note. So we took this as a model to make a new instrument. And this instrument had much the same mapping, so you can move the head to make these different notes, these discrete notes. But it had a mouthpiece that had more sensitivity than just the onset. So you could have some kind of expressivity by biting down on this mouthpiece. So here we see Peter Larsson who's performing, and Peter had a very specific request. He said, "I want to play an organ that makes sound. That makes colors. I want to make a color organ." So so this is the video by Frida Abtan, which basically when he's playing, he's making these different colors of the painting. And so what you see is what's happening too is as he's producing these notes, there's also once again a score which is produced for the other performers so that they can kind of follow along with the same melody that he's playing.
Thank you.
the sense of tactility was very clear. The idea that this was Lars who was playing this, and this was kind of his own instrument that was also designed for the shape and the size of his wheelchair. He could obviously feel with his hands the vibration. He could try putting different objects on. So the tactility of it was really very appealing. So in his next project, this project is called Parlor Sounds, and this was the Science Festival. This was a kind of a music theater piece. So I used almost entirely instruments that had ultrasound sound. There's two instruments here, you probably don't see what they are. The two instruments here are radio, so that's obviously very easy to just have as onboard speakers, but it was kind of to have the look of the theatrical feel, you know, that they would fit into this kind of vintage stage of this woman who's doing basically housework at home and listening to the radio and so on. And also this iron is an instrument, and the iron has onboard speakers. So that's the radio, which has a Vidogon Black processor and a Vera shield for the audio, and this is for the clip. So she would just be doing these very simple household things, like polishing something, and the sound would be processed by this radio. And this is the iron, which basically, the iron, it's an actual vintage iron, which we took all of the parts out of. And this was, by the way, when I started working with this project with Bella, I worked with some Jack Armitage, who is at Queen's University, where they developed this process. And so we put this little microphone. So you can imagine, when you're ironing, you put it in the relaxed position, it's here, so then the microphone would be close to her, so she could sing into the microphone, and that would actually determine the pitch. There was no recording of her voice, but she could influence the pitch of the synthesis with her voice, and then she'd put the iron down to iron, and it had an accelerometer which would take the position. Also, the accelerometer would just tell you, now it's in the relaxed position, don't play. Alright, so when it was like this, it wouldn't play, and when you put it down, it starts to play. And you can see here that there are two transducers which are actually on. This is a really nice stainless steel body on it. So it makes this body resonate. And then we used a metal ironing board, which actually do exist. There are metal ironing boards, and so it had a really nice resonance with that. So that brings me to the project that I wanted to mostly talk with you about and maybe get your input about, because this is the most recent project. So this is a system of tiny motors, as you can see here. These are the vibrators for telephones. So they're actually very, very inexpensive. They're also not super well calibrated, depending on the quality you get, but these are extremely cheap ones. Say maybe less than 1 euro for each motor, maybe more like 15 centimeters actually. And what they're doing is, you can see that they're sitting, some of them are sitting properly, but these ones are sitting properly. They're sitting between the strings, okay? So when the system is in place, you can still play the piano normally. I'm not supposed to touch the strings, but there's here we can use a better location sitting between the strings. So you can play the piano normally, we don't hear anything. But when you send energy to these motors, then it vibrates and it plays the strings by the action. So let's see that's a different. Oh, and it was controlled by a keyboard. So it's here. So sure you will actually see it involved in the vibration itself. Can you see the vibrating one? And so on. Okay, so just to talk about the development towards that, what I first started with was that these would be handheld. This is an ensemble called Explore Ensemble. So first I had this as a kind of a glove. So you would have these motors on your fingers and then touch the strings with it. And actually I have a little video where you can see them doing this. I'm just talking. Yeah, I mean you can see that they're doing this.
The strings of the piano to sound by a mechanism.
Sorry, the way the video is edited is a little bit hard to hear exactly what they're doing. But basically, I have to say this system did not work as well as I would have liked. The reason was that you see that it's really designed to have rigidity. And this part was designed with somebody called Konstantin Leonenko, who was working in our hack space. And the idea was to build in some kind of rigidity so that you could move your fingers easily and touch the strings. But actually, rigidity was not very helpful because maybe you can hear a little bit in the sound, there's a lot of noise.
An interface which causes the strings of the piano to sound by a mechanism. It vibrates very.
Basically, what happens is the vibration of the motor itself has a frequency, right? And if it's too rigid, then that couples with the string. So rather than hearing the what you really want is the motor to be very loose. So actually, if I remade these gloves, which I would like to do just for more improvisatory kind of a performance, they would be hanging rather loosely, actually. Even though this simplifies things a little bit to have things so rigid. It doesn't sound as good. So basically, the current system is MIDI, is just basically gating the voltage into that system. But the next move that I would like to make is to make an interactive system in which it's actually taking the audio and using the other one used this current one uses the Raspberry Pi because I didn't need the audio. But I would like to use this Vera, which I can use for the other projects, to use the audio analysis to gate. So basically, the piano could be an independent kind of system. You could have people performing who, through their performance, make the piano sound in a kind of a resonance. So I think that would be an interesting place to go. Another would be a somewhat more expressive system. I have to say, with just going back to the MIDI a second, that it does. Sorry, this has to go back now. The MIDI does have aftertouch, so you do have control of how much of a kind of dynamic. But then it just depends how sophisticated your keyboard is. So then to go on, I'll just do this. So there's a system called Touch Keys. Which is also made by Queen Mary University in London. And basically what it is it's an overlay for a keyboard that has sensors. So the idea would be to use this so that you could use the actual keyboard of the piano to cause the system to play. So that would be really very convenient, especially because you need to release the damper for the string to play. Right? And that happens when you play the key on the piano. So if you play the key on the piano silently without actually causing the hammer to hit, it would release the damper, and at the same time it would cause this motor to sound. Right? And then using the sensor data, you could go along the piano like this. And you could also have a blocked area, like for normal playing, and only have the motors come on when you go into. So I think this would be really the most expressive system. Maybe finally I'll just play a little bit of what this sounded like in a musical composition. So this was the premiere actually of this system was at the Huddersfield Contemporary Music Festival. So there was a keyboard, there was a pianist who had normal things to play on the piano and then also played on the system. Of course, this is just making the piano sound, and then I have this resonance system inside of the piano.